Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Lone Star Legal Aid's Law Talk Friday for today. Thank you so much for joining us. Today's presentation is going to be on 10 tips for consumer bankruptcy for our pro bono volunteers as we launch into National Celebrate Pro Bono Week beginning tomorrow. So thank you so much for everyone who is attending. This presentation is intended to serve as a legal information and does not replace legal advice. Contact Lone Star Legal Aid at 1-800-733-8394 or go to www.lonestarlegal.org for more information on legal assistance. Lone Star Legal Aid does not discriminate on the basis of race, color, religion, gender expression, sexual orientation, age, national origin, ancestry, disability, marital status, or military status, if any of its activities or operations. I'm very excited to introduce our speakers for today. You're in for a great presentation today. So first is Judge Marvin Isgur, who is a bankruptcy judge since February 1st of 2004. He was appointed to a second term, which began on February 1st, 2018. He graduated from the University of Houston Law Center in 1990. Before being appointed to the bench, he has extensive experience in representing debtors and trustees in Chapter 11 and Chapter 7 bankruptcy cases, as well as having represented various parties in Chapter 9 bankruptcy cases. We are also very excited to have us join Ms. Eloise Guzman of the Guzman Law Firm. She graduated from the University of Texas School of Law and has been licensed since 1985, has represented creditors and consumers in bankruptcies for over 37 years, with the last 22 years representing consumers only as a sole practitioner. So thank you so much to the two of you. And with that, I will hand it over to you, Judge.
Thank you. Well, first, thanks to everybody for joining us this afternoon. This work is so important to the clients that you might have. People who come see a bankruptcy lawyer are usually in pretty desperate financial situation. They're often trying to preserve their home or their sole means of transportation to and from work. And that's something that they just can't accomplish without the assistance of a lawyer in a bankruptcy case. So one of the first lawyers that I ever met when I started this work, I think on the first day I took the bench, was Eloise Guzman. And so she has been here longer than I have, and it's a pleasure to be able to do this presentation with her. Eloise, you and I prepared a PowerPoint, and let's start, and let me just ask you, somebody comes to see you and they say, I need to file bankruptcy. What's important about them telling you that conclusion, and what do you need to talk to them about right when they first walk in your door?
Well, I need to know what are their needs? What do they intend to accomplish by filing a bankruptcy? Are they trying to protect some secured property like a house or a vehicle, or are they just trying to get a fresh start and eliminate their unsecured debt? So that is one of the first things I want to know. And I also ask them, why do you think you need bankruptcy in order to get started?
Are there downsides to filing a bankruptcy if you don't know why you're going to put the client in and they just say, look, I'm the client, put me in bankruptcy? What's the downsides to somebody going in?
Well, it may not be the best chapter or the best choice for them. They may not qualify for one chapter and may qualify for another. So we need a lot of detailed information. That intake consultation has to take place with a lot of detailed information from the potential client.
And what percentage of the cases do your clients have to give testimony under oath?
Well, in all Chapter 7s, well, in all cases, they have a meeting of creditors. So they do have to give testimony under oath that their schedules, their petition and schedules are true and correct, and that they're complete, and that they included all of their assets, all of their liabilities, their income and expenses are true and correct.
So you're going to expose them to a federal perjury charge just by filing the petition, and don't want to do that if if there isn't much upside to them, right?
Right.
So I wanted to go through, if you could talk to people, you and I prepared a list of some bankruptcy goals where you might want to advise the client just to be patient instead of quickly filing a bankruptcy petition. Before we do that, let me just explain to our listeners that filing a bankruptcy petition itself is really easy. It's like one piece of paper with a signature on it. Now, you might do it wrong, you might get the client in trouble, but commencing this case is easier than filing a lawsuit, and suddenly all of your client's assets are owned by a trustee. So these are things that you need to be sure what the goal is so that you can help determine if the bankruptcy can provide it. So let's talk about someone that is getting harassment from credit card companies or other unsecured creditors. If that's what's happening, is it usually a good idea to immediately file a bankruptcy petition?
Not always. If a client is judgment proof or maybe just receiving Social Security, then they don't necessarily have to file bankruptcy, because Social Security is not subject to being seized. And so perhaps just a letter to the creditors asking them to stop all communication with the client under the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act would stop all the harassment that that particular client would have.
So we're going to get to exemptions in a minute, but why don't you briefly explain what you mean by being judgment proof in the context of that exempt property can't be seized in or out of bankruptcy, if you can briefly go through that.
Well, if a client is renting, for example, has no real estate, no liens can attach to rental property, they're not facing liens on any real property. And so all they have is maybe just their Social Security income, which cannot be garnished. In that case, then the letters would be a very good idea to send out to stop the harassment. But if a potential client has wages, then a judgment can, although we cannot attach the wages, once the wages are deposited into the bank account, then the bank account can be garnished after a judgment has been taken by the judgment creditor. And in that case, I think that the debtor would be in a good position to file bankruptcy, Chapter 7.
Can a creditor seize the bank account before they get a judgment?
As far as I know, they cannot. I believe they do have to get a judgment first. Maybe if a receiver is appointed, maybe that's a little bit different. But as far as I know, they do have to have a judgment first.
So oftentimes people come in very early in the process, and you might want to make them just wait a little bit. What if what the client says is, I want to teach a lesson to my creditors? You know, they're being, you know, sons of bitches, and I'm going to, you know, teach them a lesson and file bankruptcy. Is that worth filing for?
I think overall, first, I think they need to have enough debt to make it worthwhile, because it will affect their credit report. And also, does it make sense to pay attorney's fees for the amount of debt that they owe? So it depends on how much they owe. But definitely filing a bankruptcy would stop the collection efforts of the creditors.
You indicated improving their, that it wouldn't improve their credit. When you file bankruptcy, what does it immediately do to your credit?
Well, it will, on the credit report, it will state that the debtor has filed bankruptcy, and that information will stay on their credit report for 10 years. For a Chapter 7, and it will stay on their credit report for 7 years on a Chapter 13.
And what about if the client wants to avoid the trial of the lawsuit? Let's say in order to delay that trial by filing bankruptcy?
I think it's a good idea because a lot of times the debtor doesn't have the funds to be spending to defend a lawsuit, and it makes more sense to file bankruptcy to eliminate that potential claim.
Would you do it really early, or would you wait until you get pretty far down the road?
Well, I think that if they're having to pay another attorney to represent them, they might want to do it earlier. If there's a chance that the lawsuit might be dismissed, or whether they may want the state court to determine if there's some issue of fraud, then you may want to do that later.
All right. What are some really important things you can accomplish in a bankruptcy case?
Well, bankruptcy will stop all collection activity and allow the debtor to save their home from foreclosure. Even filing the day before foreclosure, that's enough time to save the house by filing a Chapter 13 and making a payment plan. Of course, you want to make sure that the client has enough funds to fund a Chapter 13 plan, because their ongoing mortgage payment will be included in the plan, as well as those arrears. And their arrears will be paid over a 3 to 5 year period. So they have to have the ability to pay that, that Chapter 13 plan. I am seeing a lot of clients today with arrears that are just astronomical, and there's just no way that they can pay those arrears in 5 years. They can also save a car from repossession. So the clients usually will get phone calls that they're looking for the car. And so I think filing bankruptcy before the car is repossessed is better than waiting until after it's repossessed. And again, the client will have the 3 to 5 year payment plan on paying for the car, and it will also reduce the interest rate in most cases.
So after the car is repossessed, we ought to tell people there's a few days after a repossession and before the title transfer changes from your client to the car lender. During that time period, you can still file a bankruptcy case. You can potentially get a return of the car to your client after title changes. In effect, you're dead on that issue, and you're not going to get the car back. So absolutely better before the car is repossessed.
After the car is repossessed, it's still possible to get that car back, but you do need to be familiar with the City of Chicago versus Fulton case, and that is found at 632. I'm sorry, that's found at 141 Supreme Court 585-2021.
Go ahead, Judge. No, I mean, the other things you can accomplish immediately are if you do file post-judgment and there's a garnishment against the bank account, no further garnishments can occur. And your client can get a fresh start after a period of financial instability. What you want to do, if possible, is wait until, for example, if they had a job loss, file right after they get a new job, on their way up, not on their way down, because you're only going to be able to solve problems that arose before the case filed. So you're better off with a client that is doing badly, but doing better than they were before.
The same thing if they're facing medical bills, if they're facing additional treatment, they should file later rather than sooner.
If you can. And there are going to be times when you're faced with really difficult choices. You know, your client is getting treatment for cancer and running up huge bills every month. But on the other hand, if they don't file bankruptcy, they're going to lose their car and they can't get to and from their medical appointments. So we'll have some hard choices to make. And you just need to be aware that you're making a choice when you do this.
And Chapter 7 or 13 can also be used to cancel contracts. If the clients have an unfavorable contract, they can get rid of these contracts. And they can also discharge a debt caused by a car accident, and then they can get their Texas driver's license reinstated.
What are the different types of bankruptcy cases that people might walk into your office and talk about?
Well, mainly Chapter 7 and Chapter 13. Chapter 11 is something that I don't normally handle. Chapter 11 normally is for a large business, but it's also available to consumers, but it is very expensive. Chapter 12 also is available for family farmers and fishermen. But mainly I handle Chapter 7s and Chapter 13s. Chapter 7s is the type of bankruptcy that discharges unsecured debt, and the Chapter 7 trustee liquidates any non-exempt assets. And Chapter 13, on the other hand, is a payment plan and helps reorganize the debtor's debts. And they have a 3 to 5 year payment plan that they can reorganize their debt to include their vehicle, their home, actually all their debt.
So I would suggest to those of you listening, don't ask the client anywhere early in the conversation, are you here to file a Chapter 7 or are you here to file a Chapter 13? Because even though most people walk in, they know which one they want to file, they have no idea what the right choice is. So what you want to do is figure out the right choice so you can educate the client. And that means that you need to get a lot of information from the client. So if you would walk through just sort of the schedule of what happens in the Chapter 7 and the Chapter 13, and then we'll talk about that level of information that helps you make your choices, Eloise.
Okay, well, the first step is to have a consultation with the client. And we have a 3-page intake sheet where we have very detailed questions. And then I can more or less decide whether they do qualify for a Chapter 7, because you have to qualify under the means test. And so normally I can judge it by just asking the client how much he earns. But sometimes it's fairly close where I have to ask for 6 months worth of paycheck stubs to do a means test. And then I can, with accuracy, tell them that they do definitely qualify for a Chapter 7 based on their income.
I believe that in order to qualify for Lone Star Legal Aid Services, virtually everyone will simultaneously qualify for the Chapter 7. There may be some weird exception to that, but the levels are relatively fairly high where it's going to be difficult to qualify for Lone Star Legal Aid and not be eligible for Chapter 7, but it's possible.
After that, we do start gathering all the information, and there is a lot of information to gather. It might be a great burden on the debtor to gather tax returns, paycheck stubs, tax returns, contracts, all kinds of documents. But in exchange, the debtor gets a discharge of all of his unsecured debt or dischargeable debt. So a lot of clients do complain about the amount of paperwork, but it's required and it's necessary to prepare the schedules and the statement of financial affairs. So after that, we do file the schedules after reviewing them with the client after they sign them. And then in a Chapter 7, they will have a meeting of creditors, usually within 30 days, where the trustee will ask them questions. Most of the trustees have a script and they go by the script. So they pretty much ask the same questions each and every time, wanting to make sure that all the schedules are true and correct. And one question that trips up a lot of the clients is, what is the reason that you had to file bankruptcy? And most of them say it's because I couldn't pay my bills, but we know they couldn't pay their bills if they're in bankruptcy. But the trustee wants to know what change in income or what change in expenses has the client experienced in the past. Then after the meeting, creditors normally, the trustee will file some reports and a discharge will be signed by the court in about 75 days from the start of the bankruptcy. And then the case is closed after that. The procedure for Chapter 13 is pretty similar, with the exception of number 5 and number 6 that's on the screen. And that is that you will have some additional hearings for the approval or confirmation of the Chapter 13 plan. And then the case will last 3 to 5 years, where the debtor will be making payments each month for that length of period.
So as Eloise indicated, there is a lot of data that you have to collect. Virtually all of that is completed and filled in on official forms. 90% of those are federally designed official forms, maybe 10% are some local forms that we have. It's not going to be hard to figure out what questions you need to answer. Some of the answers may be difficult to get. A lot of people believe that you can file bankruptcy for your home, but not for your car, for your car, but not for your bank account. You know, no, I'm not putting that into bankruptcy. That's simply wrong. When you file bankruptcy, when your client files bankruptcy, all of their assets and all of their liabilities are treated in the bankruptcy case. We'll talk about exemptions in a little bit, because some of those assets can be removed because of their exemptions, but you start with everything goes into bankruptcy. Your client has to submit the comprehensive list of everything to you, including their interests and their spouse's interests in everything. If your client won't provide the information, just don't take the case. I'm not saying they may not be reluctant, because people are. You're getting into their deepest financial lives, and that's very private to people. If it's so private that they won't tell you, you can't file the case. You are, by filing it under Rule 11, you know, attesting that you have done diligent inquiry. And if the client tells you that they are not going to disclose that they have, you know, another bank account that's set aside, you know, for their mom in case something bad happens to them, you've got to tell them that it has to be disclosed. You can tell them you're going to try and find ways to protect it. Can't be sure you'll succeed, but everything has to be disclosed. The information should normally be filed along with the bankruptcy petition. You can wait up to 14 days, but I think it's considered bad faith if the client doesn't initially have a bona fide intent to file all of the information. Eloise, how difficult has it been on you over the years to get people to give you their stuff, their information?
It's very difficult, very difficult. We have to help them a lot, guide them through all this, help them prepare like profit and loss statements. It's very difficult to get this information. But I would recommend not filing an emergency filing in a Chapter 7. I don't think there's ever an emergency that you have to file a Chapter 7. I think that's just asking for trouble. I would rather file a Chapter 13 on an emergency basis and then convert to a 7 if possible. I also wanted to add that assets such as potential claims have to be disclosed. Certain things that you don't normally think about as being assets, like class action cases or maybe property owned in a different country, all of those things need to be included. And I do get a lot of potential clients tell me, I don't want to involve my spouse. She has nothing to do with my debt, but we do need information from both spouses, whether they're filing or not, because the income of the non-filing spouse is still included in the means test, and their property can also might be also community property.
One of the best examples I like to give people is there's Eloise earlier described that there's this 341 meeting of creditors. Most of the time, it's only the trustee asking questions. Creditors have the right to show up and ask questions. If you want to know if your client lied, wait till the ex-wife shows up and starts asking questions. So all sorts of people can show up and ask these questions. Your client wants to be telling the truth and telling you everything. You need to let your client know that that is a mandatory meeting. They can't miss it. If they miss it, their case is going to get dismissed. They may be given another try before their case is dismissed, but eventually they're going to have to attend that meeting. And prepare them, call them, tell them, rehearse with them. These are the kind of questions you're going to be asked. And I think if you get your client used to the fact that there's going to be information and it's going to be shared, it's going to be easier. The Department of Justice has a division called the United States Trustees Division. They can appear at these meetings of creditors and ask questions, but even if they don't, the local trustees that do ask the questions will pass on anyone that they believe has lied to the Department of Justice. They must do that. They are required by statute to do that. Your client needs to be prepared that every bank statement, every tax return, every financial document may be explored. Eloise, anything you want to add to that before we move on to what the automatic stay is?
The Department of Justice has focused on self-employed individuals and 1099 workers, and also on, they focus on the cash deposits in their bank accounts and the electronic transfers, especially to family members. And I'd like to also mention that currently all the 341 meetings are being held by phone.
Phone and video, right?
Just phone, Judge.
I thought they were moving to video. They haven't done that yet?
No, they have not.
Okay. I'm prohibited by statute from attending these meetings, so that's one reason why I'm ignorant about them. But it's my understanding that they will move to a video system pretty soon. So let's move to some of the upside of filing bankruptcy. We've sort of gone through some of the downside. The first upside is what's called the automatic stay. Immediately upon the filing of a bankruptcy petition, by operation of law, with no action by the court, no need for your asking for it, a statutory injunction is imposed that stops all collection activity. It stops lawsuits from being filed or prosecuted against your client. It stops judicial and non-judicial collection efforts. It stops foreclosures. It stops the sending of demand letters. It won't stop a criminal prosecution against your client. It won't stop a child support activity against your client. So there's some exceptions to this. But by and large, the main things that you think about as being typical debt, it will stop those. It will stop student loan collection activities. That is called the automatic stay. It is very strictly enforced. If a creditor violates the automatic stay on purpose, that may be an act of contempt. And your client under Section 362K of the Bankruptcy Code can collect actual and punitive damages along with attorney's fees. If you look at Section 362B and 362C of the Bankruptcy Code, so that'll be Title 11, it's 11 U.S.C. Section 362B and C, you will see what the exceptions are to the automatic stay, but they are narrow. And one of the interesting things about this for me is the automatic stay comes into effect even to protect a client that's been a bad actor. So if your client is alleged to have committed fraud and somebody wants to come and seize their car, they still need to come to bankruptcy court first. So it's not going to be a defense that you have a bad client. That won't be a defense for the creditor. They have to stop all of those efforts. And Elias, my experience has been that we get very few violations of the stay when you compare it to the number of cases. Do you want to tell people just how powerful this tool is?
It's very powerful. It's just stops pretty much all collection activity on the debts, with the exceptions that you mentioned, Judge. And we just have very little trouble with the creditor bar in knowing the full scope of 362, the automatic stay.
So even if your client fails and will fail inadvertently to tell you the name of a creditor, that just happens. They're not going to get punished for an error that is an unintentional omission. But if they forget to list something, and so that creditor doesn't get notice of the bankruptcy case, and they proceed with a lawsuit against your client, it is still a stay violation. They still have to stop. It's just they're not going to get punished because they didn't know about the bankruptcy case. But the stay applies even to people without notice. It's just free of punishment until they get the notice. The creditor bar knows that. They will immediately stop activity. This isn't going to be hard for your client to enforce against any sort of organized institution. It is sometimes hard if they bought their home, you know, on a seller finance arrangement or something like that, where an individual doesn't really understand or says, well, I choose not to be in the bankruptcy case. So there are some people that don't, but if you're talking about any financial institution of any sort, any business of any sort, they will respect the automatic stay. So let's talk about exemptions. These are really important, especially in Texas. Your client can exempt certain property from the bankruptcy estate, but all property at the immediate moment of the filing of the petition, exempt or not exempt, has to be listed and starts out as property of the estate subject to court control. Your client gets to pick in the state of Texas whether they want state exemptions or federal exemptions. Some states they can't do that, but in here they can. There is a limited period of time for the filing of objections to what your client lists as exemptions. And if there are no objections, their claim of exemptions is then allowed by operation of law. What you exempt your property from are the claims of people that don't have liens on the property, but you don't exempt it from people that do have valid liens on the property. Easiest example is a home. And we all know that you can exempt your home under Texas homestead law. If there's a creditor that wants to put a lien on your home or already has illegally, the exemptions will take the home's equity and leave it with your client, but it's still going to be subject to that bona fide mortgage. Their credit card company can't take the equity in the home because the equity is exempt. And Eloise, I don't know if you'd like to comment on that or not.
I would like to say that you do have to choose between the two. You cannot mix them. Sometimes the state is more advantageous than the federal, depending on what kind of asset you're trying to protect. So if you have a lot of equity in your homestead, you want to select the state. But if you have a personal injury claim, then you want to select the federal.
So let's take this example. You have a home worth $100,000, and there's a mortgage on the home, a valid mortgage under state law for $40,000, and there are unpaid property taxes for $15,000. So your client has equity in the home of $45,000. That's the 100 minus the 40 leaves you 60, minus 15 leaves you 45. Under Texas law, the entire $45,000 can be claimed as exempt. But under federal law, the amount of the exemption is at least $27,900. It may be more depending upon other exemptions that are claimed or not claimed. But for the purpose of this example, we'll assume that $27,900 is exempt. So if you take that example, your client has to choose, am I going to take $45,000 of an exemption or $27,900 of an exemption? You might think that's an easy choice, but it isn't always. So here is the example, which is if your client takes federal exemptions, $27,900 is exempt, but the minimum payment and the minimum payments to unsecured creditors are then $17,100. which can be paid out in the Chapter 13 case over 5 years. But again, you're saying, why shouldn't we always take the 45 instead of the 27.9? Well, assume your client has $15,000 in cash in the bank, and you're going to be surprised. Some people do. Up to $13,950 can be exempted under federal law, but can never be exempted under state law. So if state exemptions are taken up here, your client keeps the home free of the claims of anybody, but they lose their $13,950 in cash. They are probably better off keeping the $13,000 in cash and repaying $17,000 over 5 years for most people. Hard choice. You're going to have to make that for them. Eloise, you want to add anything on that area?
No, Judge, I don't have anything to add on that subject.
In a Chapter 7 case versus a Chapter 13 case, the trustee gets all of the property and liquidates that property. The trustee can surrender property or abandon property, but the trustee has the right to liquidate it. If there is exempt property in which there is an interest above the client's exemption. So the easy example would be a bank account. Let's say your client has $40,000 in the bank, $13,000 is exempt. The trustee can take all 40, close down the bank account, and then write a check to your client for the 13. If it's a car with those same numbers, they can sell the car and give your client the cash. In a Chapter 13 case, the trustee does not come into possession of your client's property. The trustee only comes into possession of monthly payments under the plan. In a Chapter 13, your client can cure past due payments on a home, or a car, or other property, and can cure those over as long as 60 months, but maintain the regular payments that are due during that 60-month period. This is really important because let's say that your client's mortgage payment is $1,500 a month, and they're behind by 10 mortgage payments. So they're $15,000 in arrears. Going forward, they still have to pay the $1,500 a month. And on top of that, they have to pay a portion of the $15,000 every month for 60 months. So if your client comes to you and they are in default on their home, their payments will go up in bankruptcy, not down. They'll just be spread out over a different period of time. That's really difficult for a lot of people to understand. So let's talk about valuing property in bankruptcy. Can you describe what a secured claim is worth in bankruptcy for a minute for people on this first example, Eloise?
Chapter 13 allows a debtor to pay the fair market value of a certain secured items. In bankruptcy parlance, that's called cram down. So you can cram down the value and pay the value to that creditor. So in that first example, if that equipment is worth $5,000 and $20,000 is due on that collateral, then in bankruptcy, the debtor's entitled to pay the fair market value of $5,000 plus the interest.
So that applies broadly, and there are really two major exceptions. One will be debt secured by a home. It's the debtor's principal residence, not a rental home that they have, but one that they live in. They can't reduce the debt down. And the other is a recently purchased asset, which will generally be a car purchased within 910 days or anything else purchased within a year, then you can't lower the principal amount either. Can you talk for a minute about how long you have to repay the debt in a Chapter 13 or in a Chapter 7. And we'll take your example of the $5,000.
Well, if they're below the medium on the means test, then they can be in a Chapter 13 for 3 years. And so they would have to pay their disposable income for a 3 year period. And if they're over that medium income, then they have to pay for 5 years. And that would take, to obtain the disposable income, you take their income, subtract their necessary expenses, and that would leave you with a disposable income to be paid over the 3 to 5 year period.
And over that same time period is when, and you can pick, if you're below median income, as Eloise said, your plan can be as short as 3 years. For everyone else, it can be, it may be mandated at 5 years, but even the low income person can decide to do it over 5 years. And then that's the period of time that you have to pay off the $5,000 in a Chapter 13 case. What about in a Chapter 7 case? Let's say you have some equipment and it's worth $5,000 and you want to keep it. How long do you have to pay the $5,000 in the Chapter 7 case?
In a Chapter 7 case, it depends. You can reaffirm the debt and pay
it. That's reaffirming all $20,000, right?
Well, you can negotiate to the fair market value on this type of equipment. So you can negotiate to pay the fair market value and pay it over installment payments. You can, as far as the vehicle is concerned, you can pay the fair market value, but you have to pay the full amount. And there are some companies that do provide financing for this type of loan. The other option is just to surrender the collateral.
So in terms of your statutory right vis-a-vis the secured creditor, in the example that we have here, your statutory right in the Chapter 7 is to pay $5,000 in cash or to surrender it. But Eloise is right. Most of the time this gets negotiated. But in terms of just defining what the right is, you don't have the right to repay that over time in a Chapter 7. You do in a Chapter 13. The downside of taking the time in the Chapter 13 is what Eloise explained, is during that same time, your client's also paying their disposable income over. So there are really significant choices that have to be made. Another big change that you can obtain for your client is a change in the interest rate that they owe. So usually you can lower the interest rates in a Chapter 13. You can't do anything about the interest rates other than negotiate in a Chapter 7. Homes secured by principal residence are exempt or accepted from what I'm about to describe to you. But let's take a car loan with a 20% interest rate. In a Chapter 13 case, that interest rate can be reduced even over the objection of the car lender. So this is a statutorily forced reduction to 1-3% over the prime rate. So today, let's say you could do a 7% car loan, you know, 7.5% is the example I've given versus 20%. If your client has a $20,000 car loan over 5 years, they can reduce their payments from $529.88, that's the 20% interest rate, to only $400.76 at a 7.5% interest rate. And I would say of the benefits that lawyers get for their clients, this is always one of the biggest ones. I mean, it's pretty remarkable what you can do with that downsizing of the interest rate. But we do it, you know, all the time in bankruptcy cases. Eloise, do you want to add anything to that?
No, Judge.
Additional differences. In a Chapter 7 bankruptcy case, future wages and future income are retained by your client. From the petition date forward, they are not paid over to the trustee or to the creditors. In a Chapter 13 case, your client's future wages are then paid, a portion of them, their disposable income, directly by their employer to the Chapter 13 trustee. And then that is used pursuant to a plan to repay the home loan, the car loan, unpaid taxes, and then the residual is paid over to unsecured creditors on a percentage basis. When a Chapter 7 and when a Chapter 13 case end, your client gets a discharge. The discharge removes your client's personal liability on debts. It's really essential. So in a Chapter 7 case, that typically only takes 3 to 5 months. And in a Chapter 13 case, as Eloise has explained, it's 3 to 5 years. Now again, and we went through this a minute ago, the discharge does not eliminate these liens that already exist on the property. It eliminates any claim against the equity in the property or against future income that, your client might have. In Chapter 13 cases, the liens are brought current through the Chapter 13 plan, and that means they actually go away through satisfaction of the debt over the five-year period rather than through a discharge. The discharge is why you file somebody into Chapter 7. That means once they get their discharge, they can't be sued for what existed pre-petition. There are examples when people don't get discharges. That's typically where your client has lied on their schedules, failed to comply with the court order, or given false testimony. In a Chapter 13, you don't get the discharge till you make all the payments. And you don't get a discharge if you file another case within a relatively reasonable amount of time. Right now, it's an 8-year refiling for Chapter 7 to Chapter 7. But in Section 109 of the Bankruptcy Code, you can file the other limits. But even if your client gets a general discharge, as we all know, there are some exceptions from the discharge. Let's talk about the most important ones. Eloise, you want to describe the exception of taxes from discharge?
Yes. IRS taxes for the priority years, which would be the last 3 years from the due date, are not dischargeable. And if tax returns have never been filed, then they're never dischargeable.
Many student loans are accepted from discharge. Not all, but many. Child support is never accepted from discharge. What about divorce obligations, property settlements, things of that nature, Eloise?
I think that in a Chapter 13, some of the obligations can be discharged, not if they're in connection with a child support order, but property division might be dischargeable in a 13, but not in a 7.
Personal injuries caused by your client driving while under the influence are not going to be accepted from discharge. Those exceptions arise without the filing of a lawsuit. They just aren't part of the discharge. Others require the filing of a lawsuit. There are exceptions from discharge for certain types of fraud, for willful and malicious injuries, for lying on financial statements, and those have to be filed in a very promptly filed lawsuit within 60 days of that date first set for the 341 meeting of creditors that we have talked about so much. But for the vast majority of clients, their debts get wiped out. Their credit cards all get wiped out. Their unsecured loans all get wiped out. The discharge is very powerful. So what happens in court, Eloise? I'll do the first one. Every case, the computer will assign to a judge.
In Chapter 7 cases, we rarely see the judge unless there's some kind of objection to the exemption or some kind of non-cooperation by the debtor. In Chapter 13, we do see the judge quite often for confirmation hearings, dismissal hearings, modification hearings.
If you want to get courtroom experience, we apply the federal rules of evidence the same as you would in any civil proceeding in federal court. Oftentimes, the facts are stipulated, and so you don't need a witness. But if you do, It's Federal Rules of Evidence. And it's an interesting day. There could be dozens of Chapter 13 cases heard within an hour or two, but each one would be called separately and each one would be ruled on as a separate matter. So we're about at the end of our hour. We've used up 51 of our maximum 60 minutes. Eloise, do you mind if we go ahead and open it to questions at this point, or is there anything you want to add? Okay, Jessie, why don't we open it to questions in case anybody has anything? Or if you have some questions, Jessie, you go ahead.
That was fantastic. I do not see any questions. Does anyone have any questions? Definitely want to give the opportunity to those who are attending. For those of you who did not see it in the chat, that we will be sending out a copy of the PowerPoint to everyone who registered for the CLE. And so you will receive that along with the CLE information on how to self-report the hour for today.
So I want to add one more thing, which is we have this, I think, the best consumer bankruptcy bar in the United States right here in the Southern District of Texas. Our lawyers do just a fantastic job and they're committed to this profession. If you take a pro bono case and you need some help, you can almost always, because these are such good people, pick up the phone and call Eloise or one of the 20 other practitioners that devote their life to providing this consumer work, and they're going to help talk you through what you need to do. So this can be hard, but we have such a good bar, it will not be impossible. You'll be really providing a service to people, and you'll be working with some very professional people, and who you can tell just from seeing Eloise. Now, we may have picked top of the bunch here, but just how good our consumer bar is. So
I'd like to also say that they'll be working with the best judges in the country here also. And we do appreciate your dedication to educating the bankruptcy bar, Judge Isgur. I know that you were awarded with a 2021 W. Page Keaton Award for Excellence in Continuing Legal Education, a very much deserved award, and thank you.
Oh, well, thank you. Go ahead, Jessie.
We actually do have a question for you. Can you get sanctions and fees for violation by creditor if a pro bono attorney?
You know what? I'm not sure of that answer. There is a section of the Bankruptcy Code 362K, and I'm going to open it up really quickly. But I will also answer a slightly different question that I know the lawyer who asked this one, he already knows the answer, but I'm going to first answer this very particular question. Under 362K, it says that an individual injured by any willful violation of the stay provided by this section shall recover actual damages, including costs and attorney's fees, and in appropriate circumstances may recover punitive damages. So as to whether you can take pro bono fees and determine their amount, I'm not sure. And Pat, if you know the answer, why don't you go ahead and answer it since you asked the question. But I do know this, we have the authority to impose sanctions for the violation. And if I've seen a pro bono lawyer spend 10 hours having to fight a stay violation, that's a pretty good measure of the sanctions that would be awarded to the client. And I know in the one instance where I did some pro bono work and there were some sanctions that I got for against someone, I got the sanctions awarded and just told the judge that I didn't think as a pro bono lawyer I should be accepting the sanctions. That wasn't the deal. So I wanted to transfer the sanctions on over to the client. And we did it that way. And I would suspect that most of you that are volunteering might want to take some action like that. But if the person asking the question, Pat, if you know the answer, why don't you answer it? I guess he's not going to do that.
Well, unfortunately, our attendees do not have the ability to unmute themselves and speak. But if he wants to type it in, I will definitely keep an eye out in the chat or in the Q&A.
All right. But I think that's probably a pretty good answer in terms of, from a practical point of view, your client can get some sanctions awarded.
Certainly sounded right to me.
Oh, there he is.
Pat, am I right about that?
I think you are. I mean, I actually had this issue come up on a pro bono 13 many, many years ago when a mortgage lender wouldn't cooperate and had, you know, basically a pay history written in crayon and kept charging additional fees. And it really compounded the amount of time spent. And ultimately, we did not get any sanctions from a different judge who since retired. But I know that in the absence of a fee agreement, there might be a challenge in getting, you know, reimbursable attorney's fees. But I suppose your solution was a really good one. It should be counted as either punitive damages or awarded and donated to the cause, if you will.
All right. I see one more question, maybe. Is that right? No.
I will go ahead. If there's, please, anyone, if anyone has any questions, please go ahead and type them in. But if I can't, I'll go ahead and spend the last couple of minutes just talking a little bit about Lone Star Legal Aid's pro bono support that we provide for you. If I can get my, can you stop sharing your screen? I can share my screen. Thank you. So just really quickly, for those of you who are new to us and for Lone Star Legal Aid, thank you so much for first attending. Thank you again. I know that everyone joins me in thanking Judge Isgur and Ms. Guzman for your time. That was an excellent presentation. I know that I felt like this was a great Friday afternoon for me. But for those of you who are new to Lone Star Legal Aid, we do have a pro bono program, and we are always seeking volunteers to help with our bankruptcy and other debt relief matters. You are probably very much aware that as a result of the pandemic, there was a lot of financial instability that occurred for many of our clients in our communities that we serve. And the pandemic in and of itself is a disaster. And as we recover from disaster, we start to see the financial impact typically about 6 months to a year after the recovery starts to begin. And we are actually starting to see an increase in the need for debt relief and bankruptcy assistance. So thank you so much for coming today. The ways that Lone Star Legal Aid does support all of our volunteers, regardless of whether or not you're volunteering in a bankruptcy matter or another civil matter, is that all of our volunteers are supported under our professional liability insurance. That seems to be the number one question we get asked, but so just be aware that that is, you are protected in that way. We also provide assistance with language lines and other translation services for our volunteers. I do want to encourage everyone that please do not allow a language barrier to be the reason why you choose not to assist a certain client. They are already experiencing a barrier with the legal system because of that language barrier, possibly even a cultural barrier, depending on their status as an immigrant or not. And so having access to an attorney who can help them bridge that world is really very vital. And we are able to provide your resources to help our clients with the language barrier. And we also can assist with client management. There's sometimes an issue with getting a hold of our clients because they are experiencing other issues. Just always know that we are here to help you navigate all of those issues as well. We provide templates and access to best case for our volunteers if on request if needed. We also have staff attorney mentors available to answer questions. Especially if you're a first time volunteer with us, we offer free CLEs, one of which to really highlight for everyone here today. If you are new to bankruptcy, the three legal services corporations funded organizations in the state of Texas, which is Lone Star Legal Aid, Texas Rio Grande Legal Aid, and Legal Aid of Northwest Texas several years ago with the support of the bankruptcy judges. So thank you for that as well. Created an amazing 3-hour CLE that is recorded and available through the Texas Bar CLE called A Bankruptcy in a Box. It's free for anyone who commits to taking two pro bono cases. So that is an option that's available. If anyone's interested in that, please let me know. And I'm more than happy to share the information how to sign up for that. You see the QR code to sign up for our volunteer sheet if you are interested in volunteering. Just because we did send this out to everyone in the state, Lone Star Legal Aid serves 72 counties in Texas and 4 in Arkansas, and we cover the eastern third of the state. Well, as a result of that, we actually have clients in all 4 district courts. So just because I happen to be in Houston does not mean that we're only looking for volunteers who are admitted to the Southern. If you are admitted to one of the other courts, we do seek your assistance as well. And I know that we actually have right now one client ready up in Waco in the Western District. And if you happen to not be in Lone Star Legal Aid service area, as I already mentioned, our other two organizations in Texas, Trala and Landwith, are more than happy to have you volunteer. When I send you out the information after the presentation, actually more likely be on Monday, if you are in those service areas and you need to be connected with the pro bono coordinator or managing attorney over there, I'm happy to connect you there as well.
So, Jessie, can I add one more thing off of what you said, which is you indicated that Best Case was available to folks. Best Case is a computer program that will take all of that extensive information that you need to gather that Eloise was talking about, and it will then take the information and put it in the right way into all the official forms and add and cross-check the numbers and prepare the filings you need to do and have everything file ready once you put the data in there. It's a pretty fantastic program that they're going to make available.
And as was mentioned at the beginning, thank you so much for the clarification on Best Case. This presentation was approved for an hour CLE. That's the course number. We will also send this out to you to self-report. And this presentation has been recorded and will be available for later viewing for anyone who was not able to attend today.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you all so much. I appreciate it. We're 2 minutes past the hour. Everyone have a great weekend, and thanks so much.